Today we're starting on a series entitled Victory is More Than Survival. Now, let me just kind of tell you, today I really struggled with the sermon because I'm one of those outline kind of guys. And today, because of the way the series is going to lay out, I needed to do an introduction to it. And so for me not to even have an outline is difficult for me. Because I just like things to fit that way. But there's several things we've got to cover. But let me tell you what I think we can expect and what I believe is going to take place over the next several weeks. Number one, some of us are going to be surprised. Now, surprise can be a good thing or a bad thing, okay? I'm going to tell you, I think all of us will be disturbed. It's going to cause us to ask questions. It's going to cause us to struggle with our concepts and our preferences. It's going to stretch us in our faith and in our methodology. So just get ready. I'm telling you ahead of time, that's some of the things that I think will take place. I hope you will be, as we go through this, that we will all be thinking, looking for application, we will be asking questions, and most of all, we will be praying about what God would have us to do and the part He would have us to play in what we're going to be talking about. What we're going to do in the weeks ahead is we're going to find ourselves in a place where 35 minutes is not enough time. Because we're going to be dealing with some topics that are going to stretch us. So what we're going to have to do is have more time. And so to be able to do that, starting next Sunday, we will have our sermon and our worship service as usual. But then on Sunday nights at 5 o'clock, we will meet in the fellowship hall. And that'll be a time that we are going to take what we've preached about on Sunday morning and expand it, dig deeper into it. And the way we're going to do that is Josh and Larry Thompson and myself will be on the platform over there, but we're not there to do all the talking. I want you jotting questions down, and if something rubs you the wrong way, write it down. If there's something that you say, boy, here's what I heard, here's what I think, then jot it down. And then we're going to meet over there and we're going to discuss a lot of what takes place on Sunday night in this series is going to be us talking. It's not going to be the three of us talking, it's going to be you talking, and we're going to kind of lead the conversation. Now that is a little frightening because we don't know what you're thinking and we don't know what your questions are. And so I'm hoping there are some things that I hope we have answers and I hope we can finish up some things, but there might be one Sunday that something will come up and we'll have to just say, you know what? We're going to get back to you on that next Sunday. And then we'll start the following Sunday night with whatever that unfinished thing was. And so this is going to be a very different time for our church. So please be here on Sunday morning. If you're not able to be here, watch the video. And then Sunday night is not going to be videotaped. Not because we couldn't gather all this stuff up and take it over there and do it. We could. But the purpose of Sunday night is for us to talk about it and for you to be involved in it. And if you're just watching it, you're not involved. So is there a method to the madness? Absolutely. So today, we want to start the series, Victory is More Than Survival. So to do that, I want to take you back. And I want to ask you a couple of questions. What if someone had warned 10 years ago that a great recession would be coming and that would bankrupt some of the world's largest banks? What if someone had warned that the stock market would lose half of its value? What if someone were to have told us that 1 in 6 Americans would be on food stamps and we would see more than 100,000 home foreclosures each month? We can go back further than 10 years. What if in 1980, the year that USA Today was successfully launched, someone would have predicted that within 3 presidencies, leading newspapers and magazines would be insolvent? That the Chicago Tribune would be filing Chapter 11, that the Rocky Mountain News would fold, and that Newsweek would sell its operations for one whole dollar. Well, the fact is that in each of these instances, there were a few individuals, there were a few isolated individuals that did predict this, that did foresee this coming, and they attempted to warn key players in our world, in our country. On October the 13th, 2010, the New York Times headline read, "Banks Ignore Signs of Trouble." See, the problem was that no one saw this. The problem was not that no one saw it coming. The problem was that the people that needed to be listening and the people that could change the outcome, that would change the course of action, never got the message, or if they got the message, they ignored it. Proverbs 27, 23 and 24 says, "Know well the condition of your flock and pay attention to your herds, for wealth is not forever, not even a crown lasts for all time." You say, well, why are you telling us all this stuff about the economy and about the condition of America and all that? Because the same facts apply to the church. In America today, the church, and by that we're going to define more and more what I mean. I don't mean all churches, I mean the church that God has, is standing in a very similar place to the banks, to the newspapers, to the homeowners, to the stock market traders of our near past. And according to Nichols in his book, we are on the brink of an evangelical recession. Now, I want you to take your Bibles this morning, and I want you to turn to the book of Revelation. When I say Revelation, I always get people excited. Oh, wow, we're going to look at it. Well, hang on. Revelation chapter 2. We're going to read some various passages here. Revelation chapter 2, verse 7. This is Jesus speaking. "Anyone who has an ear should listen to what the Spirit says to the churches." Drop down to verse 11. "Anyone who has an ear should listen to what the Spirit says to the churches." Verse 17. "Anyone who has an ear should listen to what the Spirit says to the churches." Verse 29. "Anyone who has an ear should listen to what the Spirit says to the churches." Chapter 3, verse 6. "Anyone who has an ear should listen to the Spirit, what the Spirit says to the churches." Verse 13. "Anyone who has an ear should listen to what the Spirit says to the churches." Verse 22. "Anyone who has an ear should listen to what the Spirit says to the churches." One of the jokes about courses over, praise courses over hymns is that it's repetitious. Well, I guess God just gave us a course. Seven times he repeated the same statement. Seven times he repeated that anyone who has an ear, anyone who has an ear should listen to what the Spirit says to the churches. See, the signs are there. But I think today the church and Christians are too busy to see them, too unwilling to look and to listen, too deceived by current successes to believe that the ministries like the industries and the governments can collapse almost overnight. Folks, we live in a 24/7 world. It is fast-paced, it's web-connected, it's electronic, and change no longer takes months and years. Change takes place in weeks and days and minutes and hours. There are things that we are sitting here today that we can look at and say, man, a year ago I never thought it would be this way. 6 months ago if you'd have told me, I wouldn't have believed it. But things are changing that fast. I like the way that the Message puts Proverbs 22:3. says a prudent person sees trouble coming and ducks. A simpleton walks in blindly and is clobbered. I like the way that's put. Folks, there are some people in our churches. There are churches walking around this world blindly today and are being clobbered. The year was 2005. New York University professor of economics, Noriel Rubini. It's interesting that his name is Noriel, and that was the character in our study on the Harbinger. This is the real person, though. Noriel Rubini sounded the warning of falling home prices that would sink the economy. 1 year later, home prices were still soaring as he spoke to the world finance leaders at the International Monetary Fund, and here's what he said. The U.S. is likely to face a once-in-a-lifetime housing bust. Oil shock, sharply declining consumer confidence, and ultimately a deep recession. His forecast included things like homeowners defaulting on mortgages, trillions of dollars of mortgage-backed securities unraveling worldwide, and a global financial system that shudders to a halt. What was the response to his warnings? Some laughed at him. Some shrugged him off. Most ignored him. His forecast earned him a title, Dr. Doom. And that title and the opinion of people nearly sunk his career. And then things started showing up on CNN and Fox News and other news media. And then it was there in our home values, and it was there in our financial, or it wasn't there in our financial investments and retirement portfolios. And our own businesses began to struggle. By the time the broader recession could not have been stopped at that point. But if Rubini's warnings had been taken serious, thousands of jobs, homes, and companies could have been saved. You say, again, Pastor, that's great. That's the world. But what's that got to do with us? Well, there was another man in 2010 who wrote an article. His name is Tom Sine. It was entitled, A Wake-Up Call for Evangelicals. And I quote, "When I attempted to make leaders in mainline denominations aware of the emerging patterns of decline in attendance in the 1980s, they were largely in denial. Denominational leaders today are faced with continuing crisis of numbers of attendance and giving that are declining every year. Now, evangelical denominations are also beginning to experience decline. 23 of 25 major evangelical denominations, including the Southern Baptist Convention, are experiencing declining attendance patterns." Well, let me ask you a question. That was 2010. Why is it the Rubini's and Sine's warnings were ignored? It wasn't because their facts were incomplete, because they were complete. It wasn't because there was a lack of credentials, because they both had their credentials. They were ignored largely because we don't like to hear bad news, especially when it affects us personally. We're too often like the city manager I worked for, and you've heard me say this before. I went to him and I said, "Hey, we've got two council members that are about ready to go to blows." Actually, they had kind of gone to blows. And he was not there when that took place. And he looked me in the eye and he said, "Don't tell me about it. I might have to do something about it." That's largely been the case of the church. Don't tell us about the bad stuff, because we might have to do something about it, and we're comfortable where we are. Another reason is success can cloud our judgment. When we're having success and there's something outside of our line of sight, we look around and go, "Come on, things are looking good. They're looking up. Things are going great." I just read this morning about a church in the Metroplex who has merged with another church. Now, it was a dying church, and it was probably a good move for them. But let me tell you something. There's danger when those things like that happen. Not from the church that basically said, "We can't make it anymore. We're going to join with this other church." But it's something that you've got to be careful with. This other church goes, "Hey, things are, man, we just had a bunch of new members." Yeah, but it's about the kingdom of God, not your kingdom. And so your kingdom looks like it grew, but God's kingdom didn't change at all. See, we're looking at the wrong thing. And then sometimes success is a time when we're so overwhelmed and we're so busy that we don't have time to deal with any problems. My plate's full. I can't juggle anything else. Don't worry about that right now. George Barna writes, "The church landscape will continue to evolve into something that would have been unrecognizable a quarter of a century ago." Now, we've got a choice. We can wait 10 years, and we can keep doing what we're doing, and we can make some feeble attempts in 10 years to survive. We'll be bloody and we'll be bruised, but we can hang on. We can survive. Or we can open our eyes, we can open our hearts, we can be like the sons of Issachar in 1 Chronicles chapter 12, verse 32. The Bible says, "Who understood the times and knew what Israel should do." I truly believe that the next years ahead of us, and I'm not going to put a number on how many, but it's going to, for lack of a better way of putting it, it's going to separate the men from the boys. And the true church is going to look different than it looks today. And there will be many just surviving. But I don't know about you, but I want to do more than that. Now that I've told you all this stuff, are you adequately depressed? Some of you probably feel like, well, let's just eat dirt and die. You know, that's it. What else are we here for? But I want you to hang on, because that's not my purpose today. Not at all. But here's what's got to happen, and it's going to happen over the next two Sundays as we go deeper into the problems. We've got to know where we are, and we've got to understand how bad things are and how bad things will get before we can appreciate where we need to be. Someone once said, "You won't change until the pain of staying the same is greater than the pain of change." I want you to think about it from a spiritual perspective. Think about your salvation. We can't really appreciate salvation until we get a good grasp on what we're being saved from. I can't appreciate and I can't deal with the awesomeness of heaven until I understand the horribleness of hell. I don't really understand the glorious part of life with Christ until I understand how horrible and awful it would be to be separated from God. And so for us to understand and for us to be willing to make a change and us willing to do whatever it takes, we've got to understand how bad it really is. Sometimes the church locks itself into four walls and we become immune to what's taking place outside, or we see our numbers dwindling and we see some people coming and some people going, and we think, well, we're hanging in there, we're okay. I heard a church one time that I heard a staff member say, and it was in a large community and there was a lot of changes in the community, and he said, if we can just hold on, if we can just hold on five more years, the people that do all the studies tell us that this neighborhood is going to start to change and there'll be young couples moving in and buying these new homes, these older homes, and refurbishing them. So if we can just hold on for 5 years. And I was thinking, man, that's the way you want to go through your ministry, hanging on for 5 years? What about looking around your neighborhood and saying, this is where God's planted us. Let's do something with what he's given us. Recognize the field. Make the adjustments you need to reach the people that are there instead of just holding on for some other lost people to show up. The scene's bleak. Tougher times are coming for the church. So we're going to spend 2 weeks looking at the reality of the times, part one and part two. That's the next two Sundays. And it will be sobering. But I promise you, we're not going to stop there. I'm going to give you a two-week break there because I'm going to be on a mission trip for the next 2 weeks. But then we're going to come back and we're going to look at what we need to do to more than survive, what we need to do to thrive in the ministry that God has for us. And there are some upsides. I'll just tell you now, we're already doing some of the things. We've already started moving in some of these directions. And so some of these things won't be a change at all. I'm not going to spill the beans until we get there. But let me tell you, if you don't get anything else out of the sermon today, here's what I want you to get, because this series is going to test our loyalty. And I'm not talking about your loyalty to me. I'm not even talking about your loyalty to this church. This series is going to test our loyalty and the object of our loyalty. And here's the question. Here's the question that we need to be ready to answer. Am I more committed to the church and to evangelicalism as we know it, or to Jesus Christ, His kingdom, and His message? Look at it one more time. Am I more committed to the church and to evangelicalism as we know it, or to Jesus Christ, His kingdom, and His message? Because folks, let me tell you, they're not always synonymous. I know that hurts to hear. Those two things are not always the same. I can tell you that the church is going to have to change. Evangelicalism is going to have to change. But Christ never changes. The kingdom of God never changes, and His message never changes. But we're going to have to adjust to be where He is. We've got to quit building our kingdoms and start building His kingdom. From the time of the founding of the church, she's always faced change. But Jesus, the founder and the cornerstone, made a promise, and He recorded it in Matthew chapter 16, verse 18. He says, "I will build My church, and the forces of Hades will not overpower it." You say, then what do we have to worry about? Why should we worry? Well, we ought to worry because I want to make sure we're His church. Not Glenn's church, not your church, but His church. Because this doesn't mean, this statement that He makes, this promise that He makes, doesn't mean that every little church out here or every large church out here is going to survive. Matter of fact, let me tell you, there's going to be some that will survive and thrive. Number one, they're not preaching the gospel, so they don't have anything to worry about. But number two, there are others that will make it and they'll just hang on. But He says, "I will protect My church." That means the church that's following Me, the church that's committed to Me. We're going to see attacks. You see, that's why I say that church is not going to be look in years to come the way it does now. Folks, we love our sanctuary. We love the bright lights, and we love the loud music, and we love the videos. But let me tell you, what happens when we end up living in a place where if they find out we're worshiping, they come in and kill us? Let me tell you, the music's going to come down. The lights are going to dim. And we're not going to park our cars out front and look like, dress like we're going to church on Sunday morning, because there are places all over the world that they're having to slip in the doors and slide. They're still worshiping. But for the church there, they have to do it secretly. They're still sharing the gospel, but they're having to find other ways of doing it. We have become so complacent because it's been so easy here in America. And I'm afraid those days are coming to an end. So what do you do when the world is after you? I love the illustration of Gregory Elder. He says, growing up on the Atlantic coast, he said, "I spent long hours working on intricate sandcastles. Whole cities would appear beneath my hands. One year, for several days in a row, I was accosted by bullies who smashed my creations." He said, "Finally, I tried an experiment. I placed cinder blocks, rocks, and chunks of concrete in the base of my castles." He said, when the local toughs appeared and I disappeared, he said, "their bare feet suddenly met their match." Many people see the church, and he goes on to say, "Now many people see the church in grave peril from a variety of dangers: secularism, politics, heresies, or plain old sin. But they forget that the church is built on a rock, over which the gates of hell itself shall not prevail." It's time to start being Christ-centered. It's time to recenter so that the head of the church, the head, not of my church, not of your church, not of our church, but the head of his church will be the center. And we'll follow him no matter what. No matter what the risk, no matter what the cost, we'll follow him. But let me tell you, before we can do that, we have to stop. And anyone who has an ear, let him hear. Now, I've kind of checked y'all out this morning. I'm glad I have ears. Number one, it's what holds my glasses up. But I've looked around and every person here has ears. I've been in some sanctuaries before where there have been people I've known that didn't have ears externally. They had some that were made and put there, but they could still hear. But whether it's not about just hearing, it's about understanding. Folks, we've all got ears to hear, and we need to listen. Now, there's a lot of external things that we're going to talk about. There's some internal things that we're going to talk about. But let me tell you, until the church deals with sin in the church, we can't move forward. Until when I look at the Revelation passages we were reading, let me just kind of take you back through that. We won't read those seven repetitious things. Let me just pull some things out of each of those letters. These were letters to the churches. See, if you think we have things like this going on in the churches today. Jesus says, but I have this against you. You have abandoned the love you had at first. You've abandoned your first love, of course, Jesus Christ. He told them in Smyrna, you are about to suffer. Look, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison and test you, and you will have a tribulation for 10 days. Be faithful until death, and I will give you a crown of life. He's saying persecution's coming. He told the church at Pergamum, but I have a few things against you. You have some there who hold to the teaching of Balaam, who taught Balak to place a stumbling block in front of the sons of Israel to eat meat, sacrifice to idols, and commit sexual immorality. Therefore, repent. Our sins look different, but it's the same need of repentance. He told them in Thyatira, you tolerate the woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess and teaches and deceives my slaves to commit sexual immorality and to eat meat sacrificed to idols. He said in Sardis, you have a reputation for being alive, but you're dead. Be alert and strengthen what remains, which is about to die, for I have not found your work complete before God. He told them in Philadelphia, I know your works, because you have limited strength and kept my word and have not denied my name. Look, I have placed an open door before you. Can he say that about us? Because you've been faithful to me, I'm going to place an open door in front of you? Because you've kept my command to endure? And then to Laodicea, I wish you were either cold or hot. But because you're lukewarm and neither cold or hot, I'm going to vomit you out of my mouth. Some of the same things he told those churches. And I'm not one that says this is this church age and this is... I think we can look at every one of these and find them in the churches today. Those attitudes. Oh, it's not Balak and it's not Balaam, but we have our idols. We have our false gods. Until we deal with the sin inside the church, we're not going to change the world outside. And I'm going to tell you, some of the sins we would all agree on, others we'd go, well, really, is that really bad? We better start letting God's word say what's sin and quit making up what's right and wrong on our own. How do we go forward from here? Gabe Lyons writes, I believe this moment is unlike any other time in history. If we fail to offer a different way forward, we risk losing entire generations to apathy and cynicism. Our friends will continue to drift away, meeting their needs for spiritual transcendence through other forms of worship and communities of faith that may be less true, but more authentic and more appealing. Church, we've never been called since the history of the church, actually since the history of God's people, to take the path of least resistance. We are always going to be in the face of the culture. And maybe that's why our culture is the way it is today. We haven't been in the face of the culture. But what we're going to find out as we go through this series, there's a right way and a wrong way to be in the face of culture. We've done some ungodly things in the name of God. We've carried on some ungodly attitudes in the name of Christ. And for that, we've got to repent. And we've got to understand why we're here. Things are going to get tough. And we've got a choice. We can hang on, or we can build our kingdom. And there's a lot of folks around building their kingdoms. As a matter of fact, when I look back in the history of the Bible, I look even in the Old Testament, was that not really what was taking place when God told Moses to speak to the rock, and the second time he spoke to the rock, or he smote the rock? He's going to do it his way. Is that not what was going on with David when David was supposed to be out leading the army and he was at home looking at Bathsheba? He's going to do it his way. Is that not what was taking place with the disciples when they were looking at each other and saying, hey, who's the greatest? Is that not what happened so many times as we read the stories of the early church when it became building their kingdom instead of building the kingdom of God? Is that not what's still going on today? We're trying to build our kingdoms instead of his kingdom. Some sobering questions. But we must follow him. Because he's the one that said, the gates of hell will not prevail against my church. Christ offers us more than survival. He offers us victory, but our victory is in Christ, in Christ alone. Is that where you'll take your stand? Will we stand together in that? Will we be willing to be different? See, we've talked about revival, and we've talked about a lot of things, and the more we've talked about it, the more convinced I am it's not going to look like it has before. It's going to be different. But God's got us here for a purpose. And I might not be able to change the entire world, but I tell you what, I can have a mark on this community. And you can have a mark on this community. And what if God wants to start, of all places, right here in Iowa Park? Now, I think he's working in some other places, because I've heard from some people, not using the same text, not the same thing, but I've heard from some other ministers who are teaching some very similar things right now, calling the church to be the church. And so I just believe that when God starts doing that in places, that he's trying to do something much greater. And I want to be a part of it. Anyone who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches.